Hello everyone, my name is Mayur Jadhav, and today I'll be talking about how we build data platforms from business stores with the help of Clojure. Okay, so just to introduce myself and what we do, I'm a co-founder of DataOrg. We provide data orchestration solutions. So we mainly focus on building easy to manage data platforms, which are optimized in terms of resources, utilizations, as well as money, right? So if not that, then we try to generate the need of building data platforms by writing web crawlers or working on some kind of products which are data-backed. Okay, so few initial slides, I'll try to explain what are the challenges are there for any particular startup to get on with the data platforms, and the kind of approach that we have used to quickly build a data platform. Also, I'll explain what kind of use cases that particular architecture solves. Later on, I'll try to explain the actual development challenges that we face while developing these data pipelines, and how we use Clojure to quickly build this pipeline. Okay. So let's see how data platform grows with your product. Let's just say that every product comes with a wide range of use cases for building data platform. So let's say you have a user management product, and when you start collecting user interaction data, and then eventually you might do some kind of behavioral analysis on top of that, or you might do some kind of forecasting using ML models. But initially, as your data is less, you might not need the data platforms. But eventually, as your database grows or your user base grows, you will have to build a data platform. But for any product, the initial architecture looks similar like this, where you have the users, they are talking to web servers, the data is being fetched from the primary databases. And I would say a lot of startups are mainly focused on building their products and not on the building analytics platforms. Those parts are obviously the secondary. So with the initial setup, what they try to do, even with the basic kind of analytics, they can just get it done with the primary data store by doing some kind of aggregations or doing counters or doing some averages. But as your user base grows, you can't afford to do those kinds of aggregations on your primary database. So in that case, the easiest solution that you can think of is move your all aggregation queries to some replica DB. But this is just a small use case where it will solve some small set of use cases of analytics. For example, consider I want to do user interaction behavior, or I want to do some kind of feature usage-based analysis. Then this kind of report won't help me because this still has the current state of your system. And to see the better picture of your product, you need a better insight. So basically, it gives a better understanding of your product, how it's behaving with other customers. And this also helps to generate the need of next cool features. Even your business team needs an internal analysis of how features are being used by the existing customers to onboard their new customers. So it's clear that these basic reports are not enough, and you won't survive long with this. And you need deeper insights. So what's the next step? So obviously, the next step is having a full-fledged event-based architecture where clients are sending custom events to your event server. Then there is like huge MapReduce-based Hadoop cluster setting doing all the aggregations. And then it's generating a lot of advanced reports. But this whole process costs a lot in terms of money as well as time, because you need to hire like data engineer experts and who will be doing all these kinds of big Hadoop-based infrastructure setup. Also, it affects the product timelines, because you have to start making changes to your code, which will start sending custom events to the servers. Or you might have to write event server for that matter. But is there a simple step before this? If you consider it, any analytics or any advanced analytics is always around your business store, right? So can we use that and generate some kind of events pipeline from the business store and get your advanced reports from that? Now the question comes, how you are going to transform your business store, which is maintaining the current state of your system, and transform it into events like pipeline. So let's consider every operation happening on the database is a action type, and the change data is kind of an event for you. So every database maintains the wall log, which is write ahead logs, which has the change updates. If you have a way to stream all those events, then you can just build the pipeline on top of that. So this is the detailed architecture where data ingestion is happening from your primary databases. So there is a DBSM worker which is reading all your wall logs. DBSM is actually an open source distributed platform for change data capture. It is built on top of Kafka connector. So basically, it reads all your wall information and puts it into a queue. Then there is, it also has a lot of connectors, like commonly used are Postgres, MySQL, Cassandra, or MongoDB. Then there is a data transformation. So it's kind of a heavy lifting job where we actually process the events, and we also do the cloud setup using this library. So this is basically written in Clojure. And the last one is query services, which usually helps you to visualize your analytics or generate your analytics reports. So if you see, there are three important parts of this architecture, and it is designed in such a way that every part is independent. So it's like you can take any part of this architecture and plug into your existing infrastructure. So for example, you have an events pipeline, and then you just want to, your events are going to some queue, then you can just use the data transformation library and just start generating your reports. Okay, so now we know how we have built this data pipeline, but you still need to understand what kind of use cases it can solve. Obviously, the first one is building online analytics processing pipeline on top of RDBMS. I'll explain what kind of reports it can generate. The second is function triggering platform. So triggers are kind of a non-blocking actions for end users. You can consider them as like, for example, I'm registering a user, and after that I'm sending an email for that registration. Then sending an email is kind of a non-blocking action, which is a trigger. So all kind of side effects that you can see is kind of a trigger, and just imagine you are triggering all those actions from that chain stream. The other use case is taking a cheaper point-in-time backups. Also, you can just replicate your data store from one data store to another data store with the help of this architecture. So now let's see an example of OLAP from RDBMS. Let's consider an example of CRM where tickets or issues are being reported by customers. Then there are agents who are doing the replies. Then they are resolving all the issues. And all of these operations are happening on a single table, which is tickets table. So from that only, from the chain stream of that table, you can generate analytics like how many tickets are resolved per day, how many tickets are opened, how you can derive metrics like how your agents are behaving, how what's their resolution rate, or what kind of performance they are doing, right? You can also see the average response times and average resolution times. Second example is of transaction data, where every transaction is a single row. You are updating the same row by adding some balances or deducting something from it. So there might be a there is always a possibility that you want all the reports related to particular period, how many balances detected in particular period, or how many receivables are there in particular set of period. So even that can happen with this change data stream. You can see the analytics happening, or the accumulation happening every day. I'll show demo of how this change data stream happens, how it can help you to trigger some kind of action. I'll just give you a demo where there is a insert happening on the database, and with that operation, I'm consuming that event from the other end, where it will send an email. Is it visible to everyone? So all the services are Docker containerized. The main services are like one is Postgres, where we will be inserting the data, Kafka and Zookeeper for adding all those events to the queue. Then there is a consumer which will be doing the performing the action, and the connectors are Debian connectors which will be reading the your wall logs. Now I'll just create a simple table where there is a simple email ID and some information. Now we'll start a connector which will read wall logs for this particular table. So this is a Debezium connector. Once this connector is started, we'll start the Kafka consumer. Okay, now it will just start a consumer where you can see the event as soon as something is inserted into a database. Now this is inserting a single entry. Now you can see this is the structure that we get. At the other end, this is the structure of wall log. Also, Debezium adds some extra information. Also, so it's like you get the before and after of the data change. You also get what operation happened. Initially, it's a create operation. You can also see the whole schema of the table so that you will have better understanding of what kind of modeling that you want to do on that particular event. And now you will see this action has been performed of sending an email. Now we'll just do one more thing. We'll just update the same record and see what kind of events that will generate. You can see that it has generated operation called update. So U represents an update. And it again sends an email on this particular action. So you can basically decide what kind of action you want to take on a particular set of operations, right? So now you have a better idea of how we are doing it, how we are using database operations as our chain stream operations as our events pipeline. Is there any questions so far? Like, is there any doubt how it's working exactly? Because the next part is the critical one where we have actually developed the whole data pipeline with the help of Clojure. Okay, so to begin with this, before you need to understand what kind of pain points are there for developing any kind of data pipeline, so that it will be easier to you to understand how Clojure helped us in this case. The first thing is understanding the data. So if you don't know how the data is structured, then it is really hard to write those aggregation scripts, even if you know the end result. And in this case, you know that there are multiple sources. The data is coming from different sources. Each has a different type of data structure. And with the complex queries, it's always a possibility that you would like to do the join of all those multiple sources to get the better picture. So you need some way to play around with your data. And consider an example that your raw data or events data is sitting on S3, which are like JSON files and which are mapped by Apache Hive, which is a SQL interface for mapping HDFS files or external files. And it's a SQL format, so you know what kind of limitations are there for doing some kind of playing around with the data. There is another use case which you can follow is using some kind of analyzer tool like Apache Pig, but it also gives you data in the format of tuples. And we also know that if you get a power like REPL and the Clojure, how you can manipulate data, how you can easily play around with your data. Second most important thing is doing local development. It's really hard to do or set up the whole Hadoop kind of a cluster on your local machine because it's always a single machine and there is a lot of services, there are like a lot of moving parts. There is always chance that some service will go down because of memory issues. So it becomes really painful to do the local development. Even in that case, you need some kind of a way to run your scripts in distributed mode, so that you have the better understanding how it's going to work in your production. I remember one incident where we were working with one startup which was heavily into image processing. So they wrote all their Python scripts, they run it on a single GPU nodes. And when we came in to set up their whole data pipeline, and we ran all these scripts, we realized that it was not using the full capacity of the cluster. Then we started digging up in their code and we realized that it's just using a single node because they haven't tested it on the near production environment. So these kinds of challenges are there. You must have some kind of a way to do a distributed mode development locally so that you can quickly get into a understanding of how it will work in the production. And for doing that, you maybe need some kind of better APIs to set up the cluster for development, do the development, and destroy the cluster. Integration testing, it's a really important part, and most of the cases we don't do that for data platforms at least, because it's really difficult because of two things. One is there are a lot of moving parts, because data being transformed from one data store to multiple data sources, data stores, and it is happening with the map-reduced jobs. So you need powerful APIs to understand what's happening. What is the current state of your job? What are the possible ways to get the result? The second thing is you might have to keep your infrastructure running just to run this integration test. So also there is one more important thing in doing integration testing, or not just integration testing. If you know about user-defined functions in MapReduce, so consider a simple user-defined function can be a date formatter. So you are applying a date formatter on every event. And to do that in Java, you have to write that UDF in Java, you have to build the jar, you have to upload the jar to cluster, and then only you can run that, use that function in your Hadoop cluster. And imagine that doing in Clojure. You just write the UDF functions in Clojure, test it on REPL, right? Initially, we always go with the random heavy nodes for initial setup of your infrastructure because initially we don't know what kind of data is going to be there or what kind of or how much data will be processed by one particular node. So we don't have any idea of how it's going to behave in actual production. So we just go with the random heavy nodes to deploy. And then after some time, we realize how it's working exactly. And then we scale down or scale up. So it is always better to have this understanding while you're developing. If there is a way to run all those huge big data jobs on your with the help of this infrastructure, So you need a way to spawn that cluster, runtime resize it or scale up or scale down based on the requirement. So these are kind of pain points which helps you actually which should solve your problem easily and quickly. And let's see how we did it. So this is the library that we have written, where we have four more important components, where we provide cloud support for AWS and Google. So that is basically for managing your infrastructure. So a lot of APIs, or even for using different services from all these cloud platforms. Then the DAG execution. It's like whenever you run any MapReduce job, it creates a DAG fashion task. That similar thing that you can replicate in your development as well, because there is a possibility that one job is chained with multiple scripts. And there is also a possibility that one job is dependent on another script, or maybe they are independent. So there should be a way so that you can design the whole thing. Right now, we support Apache Spark, Apache Pig, and Hive for EMRs. We also have a way to schedule your batch jobs. And we do cursor management for your making it fault tolerant. Because in batch jobs, you have to maintain the cursors. Because they should be idempotent. You should, even if they fail, you should know how much data they had processed earlier. So let's look at all of these components in detail. So one can say that having a cloud support in your library is not a big thing, because there are client libraries for that. You can just write a Clojure wrapper, because thanks to Java. But consider there are like more than 50 services which are provided by all these cloud platforms. And imagine that you have to write Clojure interop-based wrappers for all these services. It's not scalable. So we actually referred a library called Amazonica, which is a Clojure client library for AWS services. What they have done is they have used Clojure interns to transform the Java classes into Clojure namespaces. So there wasn't any full-fledged Clojure client library for GCP for that. So we referred that library, and we have created a Clojure client library for Google platform. So this is how it looks in Java class and how it gets transformed into a Clojure namespace. So basically, it converts all your parameters into a command-like keywordized parameters. This is an example of how you can add or submit a particular job on your EMR clusters. So we are, in our case, we are using AWS EMRs. So as I said, DAG execution, where you have set of scripts chained together, where you want to do, where you want to maybe pass output of one job to another job. There may be a way of sending a context across the jobs. Also, you need to handle failures of in between jobs. So we have used a library which does this, which actually does. Uses Clojure futures and maintains all those future objects. So this is how it looks exactly, where you can just easily define all the jobs in list of maps. In most of the cases, people go for managed services for scheduling their batch jobs, like Oozie or Airflow. It's just an additional feature that we have provided, that you can just use CodeSite to schedule your batch jobs. But we do have a way to maintain your cursors. We currently maintain all the cursors on cloud storage rather than using a Zookeeper for that. So this is about the library. I'll just demonstrate how easily we did this cloud setup and how we ran our jobs using the REPL. So this is about setting up a EMR cluster, where you need to specify some kind of configuration. Is it visible?
It's clipping at the top.
Okay. Okay. So these are few parameters that you generally set for setting up a cluster, where you specify what kind of instance type you need. Here we are using spot instances to set up the development cluster, which is bidding on max price of $0.25. With this configuration, we'll just create an EMR cluster. As you can see, it has created a cluster with one instance of master node and one instance of three instances of your worker nodes. Now you can, there are like APIs to fetch the cluster status. So you can keep pulling the status of cluster, whether it is up and running, whether you can submit the jobs. So it helps you to, while writing any kind of integration test, it helps you to understand what is the current state of your cluster. And then only start your jobs or start your running your tests. So now the cluster is running with a single instance of worker. What we are trying to do here is we will submit a EMR job, which is really heavy. We want to understand what kind of node or what kind of resizing we have to do at the runtime. So here we are just adding a step, EMR step, which is doing a count on a data, which is just running a select star count star query. Now we'll go to the YAN application manager. It's it's MapReduce application manager where you can see how jobs are running, what are the tasks are there, how many tasks it's going to require to execute a particular MapReduce job. This is a UI for YAN application manager. So there are two different ways to execute your MapReduce job. One is, there are actually two different engines. One is a Tez engine and one is MR engine. Here, default engine is Tez, so this is UI for Tez engine where you can see what kind of task we are executing. You can also see how many mappers it requires, how many reducers it requires. So basically, your data gets divided into all these mappers. And each mapper runs the query, and then at the end, the reducer merges all those results. So right now, if you see, there are like 202 tasks pending. And all of these tasks are running on single instance. So what we want to do is we want to resize it at the runtime so that we can boost up our performance. So with the help of this API, I can just modify the instance count. I'm specifying 8 so that it will spawn 8 new nodes. As you can see, it has requested 8. As soon as the instances are ready, it will start moving all those tasks to the new nodes, and you can see the performance boost. So this query actually is running on like 500 million events. So these are all the mappers. If you can see, there are only few are succeeded, and as soon as we have spawned all these 8 new nodes, soon this will finish, and you will see how much time it took to complete this whole job. okay, now it succeeded, and it only took like 10 minutes to finish or counting half a billion of events. And now you can just terminate your cluster. So now you understand how easy it is to do some kind of development with this powerful APIs. If you are going with the managed services, then it's really good to have such kind of environment where you can easily test out things. You can perform, you can understand the requirements of your production environment. You can feel like production-like environment while you're developing something in data platforms. These learnings are mostly related to the infrastructure that, these are mostly related to the architecture that we have designed, where we read all the wall logs. There are few things that we need to consider while reading all the logs from the database, because there are two kind of log streamers. For example, consider Postgres, where if you start consuming wall logs, then it start accumulating all the wall logs until you read those wall logs. So for example, if you have you don't have your consumer running, then it will keep piling up on your disk. Then there is another case where they are keep flushing their wall logs to the disk. In such cases, if you are not running your consumer, then there is a possibility that you will miss out the events. Publisher process is a single threaded process because you have to maintain the sequence of events. The impact. So as we can see that we can use resources at its best because we now understand the power of APIs that we can support. And based on that, we can easily test out things. We can play around with the data. And you get the near production like environment while you are developing your data pipelines. There is no need to set up your development environment and keep it running for a long time. You can just spawn a cluster, develop something or run something and destroy the cluster. So it reduces the cost for your development. Just to conclude that, I may not say that you will use all of these features because there are already a few better practices to spawning your infrastructure. But this will obviously help you in the development. This will also help you in understanding what happens at the other end of the infrastructure from the point of view of engineer. So it's better tool to use to get your hands dirty in data platforms. And that's about it.